Hello there, and welcome back.
Do return to Old Town.
So what's the first thing you think of when you hear Dutch colonial? If you're like most people, you probably imagine some kind of symmetrical home with that unique barn-like roof, or maybe one with a passage to hell in the basement. But much like with Cape Cods in the last episode, this style is mostly known today through its revival period. In other words, the homes I'm showing you were built in homage to the original style. So what was that original style? To find out, we gotta go back to the incredibly brief New Netherlands colony in the Hudson Valley. Today, we're looking at the elusive Hudson Valley Dutch colonial. So let's get into it. Now before I get into the episode, I just want to announce that I finally launched my online art store. If you're looking to freshen up your walls with some cool abstract art, or you want to help support the channel, head over to oddlyoaktree.com. You can find that link in the description below. Your support is incredibly appreciated and it really helps me to make more content. Use the code extrafancy at checkout to get 15% off your first order. Once again, that's oddlyoaktree.com. That link is in the description. So you might remember from our first episode that America's English colonies were split by a Dutch colony in the Hudson Valley. I'm not going to get too deep into the history, but here's a brief rundown for context. In the early 17th century, the Dutch West India Company began setting up their colony in North America. Settlers arrived in 1624 to establish a fortified town at the mouth of the Hudson River they called New Amsterdam. This colony would spread up the river valley to present-day Albany, but also eastwards through Long Island and into Connecticut, as well as southwards through New Jersey and into Delaware. The city of New Amsterdam is often considered one of the first cultural melting pots in America. Alongside the Dutch and indigenous people, there were also Africans, Scots, Germans, Scandinavians, French, English, Muslims, and Jewish people, among others. Now, as I said earlier, the Dutch foothold in North America was incredibly short, as in 1664, only 4 decades after the first settlers arrived in New Amsterdam, the British came a-knockin'. The Dutch settlers, feeling ignored by the Dutch West India Company, weren't willing to take up arms and agreed to a zero bloodshed surrender. That is, so long as the colony's people retained their freedom of religion, and of course, their public houses weren't closed. And thus, the melting pot that was New Amsterdam became New York. When the English took control, they didn't displace the colony's landlords. So, despite becoming a part of New England, the homes and culture would continue to carry the diverse characteristics of New Netherlands. It's important to remember that before analyzing the style, because even though we refer to this style as Dutch, the Dutch were but one of the contributors to it. A major contributor, most certainly, but one that was open to suggestion. Take this home, for example, which blends a Dutch-style roof with the layout of an English salt box. We'll talk about the salt box in a future episode. Dutch homes were notorious for being built iteratively over generations, and sometimes the original section of the home would showcase completely different trends and cultural traditions than its later additions. So, I guess, TLDR, Dutch homes are kind of complicated, and it's difficult for historians to pinpoint exactly where and how certain traits and traditions developed. Keeping that in mind, let's look at some of the trends that were common in these Dutch colonials. And I think we all know the best place to start. What's with that roof? Of course, I'm talking about how they have little to no rake overhang. That's the part of the roof that overhangs the pitch section of wall. I'll just say now, our build won't have a narrow rake overhang, because The Sims 2 just doesn't let you do that. Also, like, roofs in this game are already super finicky, so there's that. But seriously, let's talk about these barn-like roofs. So this is called a gambrel roof, and believe it or not, it was not invented by the Dutch, but rather passed to them via the English. So what's great about these roofs is your upper floor would have a full-height ceiling while only being taxed as an attic space. That's money in your wallet. With that said, this style of roof wouldn't be popular until the mid-18th century, well after the English gained control of the region. That's why you'll often see homes with gable roofs over the original house, and then a gambrel roof over the later addition. Now, that's not to say these early roofs didn't have a little flair to them. In fact, they often had a little flair to them. This is a pretty distinct aspect of these homes, but curiously, it's not fully understood why the Dutch started building their roofs like this. Neither the neighboring English colonies nor the Dutch back in Europe appeared to do this. One theory is that it's a holdover from French-Flemish thatched roof traditions, meant to protect plaster walls directly under the eaves. French-Flemish traditions may also be what influenced the more prominent use of stone masonry among rural examples of these homes. Urban examples, meanwhile, tended to opt for the more typical brick construction, The Dutch were known around the world for being among the most talented brick masons, after all. Many urban buildings also embrace the stepped parapet, common back in Europe. And speaking of masonry, notice the dual chimneys. Similar to Stoneenders in neighboring Rhode Island, the Dutch differed from other northern colonies as they built chimneys on the sides of their homes rather than in the center of the home. Also, unlike the English, their chimneys don't extend from the wall but stay flush with it. Dutch fireplaces are actually completely different than English ones. To start, the hearth was open, often with a short curtain lining the hood to catch smoke. By building the fireplace like this, more heat would be retained inside of the home, making them much more efficient than their English counterparts. On the exterior, you can often see a section of exposed brick at the base of the chimney. I found one source that said there's evidence of these being for the installation of a bake oven, but that article only cites concrete evidence of this in early examples, whereas the point of doing this in later homes still appears to be a mystery. If you know why the Hudson Valley Dutch colonials did this, please let me know in the comments. I would love to know. But perhaps one of the most intriguing mysteries within this style has to do with the origin of the American front porch. You see, the front porch seems to have proliferated across the continent by the mid-18th century, despite seemingly being non-existent at the beginning of it. While the Dutch are believed to have introduced the stoop to the Americas, the term stoop is Dutch in origin after all, many rural homes appear to have been built with full-width front porches. Previously, it was thought these porches were later additions, but later analysis of their construction, as well as depictions of these homes in art from that period, show this doesn't appear to be the case. This would make these homes among the first in North America to have a front porch. But with that said, because of the diverse influences at play within North America's Dutch culture, the jury's still out on how the front porch entered the American tradition. Some historians argue of a French origin, like the galleries lining the French plantations in the south, while others point to the Caribbean and Africa as the origin to both porches and the gallery. Lastly, let's talk about those doors and windows. Starting with the windows, their story's pretty similar to the English. Early homes have leaded glass casement windows with diamond-shaped panes, while later homes would opt for double-hung square panes. Doors, on the other hand, are a story in their own right. The Dutch split their doors in the middle, so the top and bottom opened independently. We call these double Dutch doors. It's thought these were designed to let fresh air into the home while keeping livestock out, but just like with the rake overhang, you can't build these in The Sims 2, so our build won't have one. And so let's talk this build. Today, we are reimagining the Morris Cottage. Okay, so I just want to point out that this home has the same walls as every other house we've done. We'll be changing that to siding and stone masonry. Outside, there's a little fenced garden, as well as this orchard, some bushes, this little birch grove, and these hills out back. We also have this white picket fence wrapping around the entire property. Inside, we enter the main room connected to a bedroom and bathroom at the back. This home is just a simple three-room square house with a projection at the front. Seems simple enough, right? Right? I actually end up deleting everything at one point to have a do-over. I think it turns out fine in the end, but if I could start over, I definitely would do a few things differently. But I am not gonna start over. Honestly, it turns out quite nice in the end, and I don't want to rebuild this roof, at least not anytime soon. So I'll talk more about the build at the end of the video, where as always, we'll wrap things up with a before and after. So catch you there, see you at the end! And welcome back. Okay, so to start things off, boy, building this roof though. Whew. Oh boy. I think we can all agree it was pretty important that our home ought to have a flared gambrel roof. And conveniently enough, The Sims 2 specifically has flared roofs. So easy peasy, right? Right? Okay, well, remember how I said these homes don't have a rake overhang? Well, for some reason, when you build a flared roof in The Sims 2, they're all overhang, baby! Why is that, you ask? Correct. Alright, so flared roofs were brought into The Sims 2 to mimic a big pagoda style, but like, if you wanted to build an extended rake overhang, it's so easy to just build the roof out an extra tile. Why did they needlessly complicate everything? What this means is that in order to use this roof, I have to manually build the gambrel wall, which isn't impossible, but oh boy is it time consuming. In order to build a customized wall pitch, you have to use the constrained floor elevations cheat, digging below the wall so that you can mirror the pitch you want. Next, you level the wall at the top, and then when you level the ground, you'll be left with your custom pitch. Overall, I think the majority of the time spent on this build was with the roof. But that said, I'm not disappointed. If I was starting from scratch, yeah, I'd definitely do some things differently, but I'm still happy with how it turned out. Except right here. Although you can build shed roofs in this game, you can't decide which way the roof slopes. So in order to build it like this, I actually had to build a full gable roof that's hidden underneath the main roof. I only notice now that it's sticking out the back. I'll have to fix that. Cool. Moving on from the roof, I really wanted to have this home feel like it was some old overgrown cottage. Also, with how this neighborhood is oriented, I thought it would be really cool to make this a beach lot with a steep rocky cliff subbing in for that small hill at the back of the original. And if you look past the duchy on the left-hand side, you can find this little path that goes down to the beach. You can also totally grow your own food in this garden and orchard. If you want to. I won't force you or nothing. The front still projects slightly at the house, but I decided to recess the entryway because this wall is a little bit shorter and I didn't want to risk breaking the door. Moving inside, you can see how the corner walls are a little stunted. That's because walls in this game have a minimum height restriction that no cheat can overcome. So when we built our gambrels, it pushed the upper walls down, causing this to happen in the corners. You can see I used the fireplace trick from the first episode to give this tiled fireplace a brick chimney. Even though this isn't a Dutch style, many a Dutch fireplace have similar tile work, so I thought it was good enough. I also built out the walls above to sort of pay homage to the actual colonial Dutch fireplaces, although I couldn't include a curtain. Most wall objects can be raised and lowered with the square bracket keys, but for some reason, curtains raised for nobody. I also used a set quarter tile placement cheat to move the fireplace back ever so slightly to expose the base of the chimney. I then also added some basic kitchen, bathroom, and lighting fixtures because, you know, why not? Well, I'm here, right? In the next episode, we'll be moving across the continent to explore a style that largely no longer exists in its pre-revival form, and yet had a profound impact on later American homes. For that episode, I'm actually going to be redecorating a build from my Old Town series to better fit in with the new direction that we're going in. I've definitely learned a bunch of new tricks since my earliest builds, so I'm pretty excited to show you all what I do with the dang place. Whichever place that may be. I don't know. You'll have to tune in to find out. So be sure to subscribe to catch that episode as soon as I upload it. Also, if it's not too much trouble, please leave a like and a comment on this video. It really helps the show gain traction with the YouTube algorithm, which helps me reach more people. You can also support this channel and download every lot from the series by becoming an extra special potato chip on my Patreon. That link is in the description below. Finally, you can support this channel by buying my art via the new and improved oddlyoaktree.com. You can buy these prints in multiple sizes, from 8x10-inch prints all the way up to 24x36-inch prints. Better yet, we ship international, baby! So long as you're on this planet Earth, and you have an adequate postal system, you should be able to order a print. Use the code EXTRAFANCY at checkout to get 15% off your first order. I'm super stoked to finally be getting my art store up. It's something I've really been wanting to get organized for quite a while. So please support this channel and check it out. Head to oddlyoaktree.com. That link is in the description. And that wraps up this episode. Thank you all so much for watching. What's your favorite bit of the Hudson Valley Dutch Colonial? Let me know in the comments. As always, I'll leave you all with the before and after. And until next time, have a good one.